and Jerusalem has been devastated again, despite many of its inhabitants already having been taken into captivity to Babylon in earlier raids. Now they find themselves as slaves there. The majority are labourers on... Okay. One moment. The best laid plans of mice and men. I'm the mice. Okay, I think you probably would have heard what I said anyway. I'm a very loud speaker, aren't I? Even without the mic. Okay, the majority of the Israelites are found by the rivers of Babylon. Ever heard that song? That's what it's about. So the Israelites are taken as laborers and slaves to build all of Babylon's great big infrastructure activities. So you've got the Hanging Gardens especially. But there's a small group that's there right at the heart of government. Who are they? You know them. The book of Daniel. Daniel and his friends. There they are. Now, they've been taken by Nebuchadnezzar. Now, Nebuchadnezzar is the king or emperor, if you like, of this new empire. This new empire, which has just sprung up out of nowhere. 100 years ago, before this time, Isaiah was a prophet. And during Isaiah's time, the empire that was at the height of its powers was, anyone know? Assyria. And Assyria conquered then the known world. But now they are weak and Babylon has taken their place. Dramatic. Dramatic how it all changed. And the first raids by Babylon on Jerusalem happened in 605 BC. Now that's 9 years before the time that we're talking about. Before the time of this letter that went from Jeremiah. Now, in the early raids, what happened is that the Babylonians took the king, as was read, and also the smart people, the strong people, the good people, the artisans, the builders. What was left? The dregs of society. What was left were the weak. For these people, you could use the word so often used in Scripture, the remnant. A remnant, and that's all they were. Now, if you go to the first five books of the book of Daniel, you'll see exactly what Daniel and his friends experienced when they went there. Now, the raids continued, and now Jerusalem was a wasteland. An absolute wasteland. In this terrible state of affairs, this unfaithful and unrepentant nation, God's people, Israel, they were left in despair. They were left in absolute despair. Despite them not deserving any help, God gave them help. How many prophets did God send to these people at this time? Do you know? One? Two? Three. One, obviously, Daniel. I just mentioned him. He was right at the seat of power in Babylon. The majority of the Israelites were actually down by the rivers of Babylon, the Tigris and the Euphrates, in that area that's such a hotbed of all sorts of difficulties in the world today. The majority were there, and Ezekiel was their prophet. Ezekiel was there among them. God sent Ezekiel and Daniel to Babylon. But back in Jerusalem, he had Jeremiah. So Jeremiah is sending a letter to, if you like, Daniel and Ezekiel and all the people in Babylon. And this is the letter that Jeremiah is sending. Is it Jeremiah sending it? No. It's God sending it through Jeremiah the prophet. During this, one of the lowest points of Israel's many low points in history, God inspires Jeremiah to write this letter on his behalf. This letter is a message of incredible encouragement to those people there. Incredible encouragement. Because although they are undeserving, it shows that God still cares for them and that he wants to help them. Despite the fact that they have given up on him, they are not asking God for help. Who are they asking God? Who are they asking for help? It's actually the Egyptians and other countries around them. They're trying to make alliances for them to rescue them. But who only can help them? Who only can help us? God, and God alone. It's now about 9 years, as I've said. 9 years is time enough to wear down the most optimistic. Have you had a problem for 9 years that you couldn't resolve? At the end of this time, they were desolate, desperate, and in a really bad state. They really were at the end of their tether. Now let's have a look at these same verses again. This time in a bit more detail. I won't ask for the first three verses to be read because I've already talked about them. The context, what has happened. What we want now is to hear verse 4.
Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, to all who are carried away captive, whom I have caused to be carried away from Jerusalem to Babylon.
Okay, what do we get from this verse? There's a couple of things. Firstly, the message is from the Lord, from God, not from Jeremiah. And secondly, Jeremiah, being a very good Israelite, he believed that God determined everything. Now, from our study fairly recently of the book of Job, we saw that who determines a lot of things? Who sends all the bad things into this world? It's Satan. God may allow it, but Satan is the author of all evil, all difficulties, all problems. Everything that hurts you is not from God, it is from Satan. But because Jeremiah is a good Israelite, he couldn't conceive of it being any other way. I forgot one of the most important things I needed to do. Place my glasses. No wonder I was struggling reading. Now, verse 5.
Build houses and dwell in them. Plant gardens and eat their fruit.
Okay. What were they to do? Were they to skulk around and be, terrorists and, cause all the problems and difficulties in the world? No. What it says here is that they are to build up the city where they find themselves. They are to settle down, plant all manner of crops, eat and survive, focus on the everyday things in life. That's really quite amazing, but Australia is a very multicultural society. And we have people from all countries of the world. I'm obviously not an Aussie, I came from somewhere else. You'd be surprised where I came from. I came from the Middle East, Iran, not even my parents' homeland of Russia. But they were in Iran running away from the communists. But all the people are to work for the country, for the city, for their neighbours, for their everyone around them. Now verse 6 says,
take wives and beget sons and daughters, and take wives to your sons and give your daughters to husbands, so that they may bear sons and daughters, that you may be increased there and not diminished.
Okay. Apart from just doing the basics, they were to increase in number. They were to live a sensible human life. They were to marry, they were to have children, they were to support their parents and their children and support each other. Everything that a sensible person in a sensible society would do. God is telling them to do this, right? Not to be terrorists, he's telling them to be good human beings and live life to the full. Now, verse 7.
Verse 7, and seek the peace of the city where I have caused you to be carried away captive, and pray the Lord for it, for in its peace you will have peace.
Build up the city's social order. Now, the city, Babylon, is obviously also the empire of Babylon. Now, it's saying that even though these were oppressors, what were they to do? They were to pray for them. We are to pray for the city that we live in, for everyone in it, even those who don't do exactly what we would like them to do, even for those with whom we disagree, maybe to the politicians even. All of them actually need our prayers dramatically. For Babylon's benefits would be their benefits also. Now what about verse 8 and 9?
For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, do not let your prophets and your diviners who are in your midst deceive you, nor listen to your dreams which you cause to be dreamed. For they prophesy falsely to you in my name, for I have not sent them, says the Lord.
Right. Don't listen to the agitators. And we live in a society where agitating is a great game. The media agitates all day long about everything that they don't agree with. And the media is not the only people. Most people agitate in one way or another. They want things their way, and if they don't get it, then they will truly upset the apple cart and revolt and rebel. But that's not what God wants them to do. Now, verse 10.
For thus says the Lord, after 70 years are completed at Babylon, I will visit you and perform my good word toward you and cause you to return to this place.
70 years. They were to be in Babylon for 70 years. For some of the young ones, those who listen to Rose's children's story, they may make it. I wouldn't make the 70 years. And there's many others here who wouldn't make another 70 years. Despite our best efforts, we wouldn't make 70 years. So, in reality, this was a death sentence for some. A death sentence outside of Jerusalem. A death sentence outside of their beloved country of Israel. The promise, though, is for the younger ones. The ones that will go back. The progeny, if you like. The descendants. So there is good news. The children would make it. The nation would survive. There would be a grand event in the future when the descendants would return to Canaan, the land of promise. And now, verses 11 to 14 are some of the best known in Scripture, certainly some of the most loved because of their encouraging nature. Let's have a look first at verse 11.
For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope.
Now God's plans for us are there. What are God's plans? Does he want us to live in poverty? Does he want us to live in fear? Does he want us to live in terror? His plans for us are good plans. They're long-term plans, these plans. They are to prosper his people. They are to help the followers, to support them and give them benefits. His plans were not to harm or hurt. So where does the harm or hurt come from? I've already mentioned it. Satan and all that follow him. So there, but also, and possibly more importantly, God's plans are to give his people, what's that four-letter word, starting with H, hope. Most of us live on hope. We need hope to go from day to day, especially when things are really terrible, especially when things are going wrong. At times as these, hope is more important than immediate relief from the suffering that's being experienced. It's an incredible balm for the soul. Balm is sort of something soothing, wonderful. Verse 12.
Then you will call upon me, your girl, and pray to me, and I will listen to you.
God will listen. Not may listen, will listen. But he will listen to us only if we go to him and ask him. Why does God do that? Why does he want us to ask him? Why doesn't he just answer us? Because he gives us choices. He's not going to impinge on you. He's not going to make you do things against your will. You have to ask. He will then give. That's the way it works. Verse 13.
And you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart.
It's not always understood exactly what this means. Those who've been in my Sabbath school classes probably have heard me say this time and time again. When the Jew said, with all your heart, when the Greek said, with all your heart, it didn't mean with some pump inside your body that rushes the little blood cells around. What it means is with your full being, with your full self, your real self, who you truly are. Not just spiritually, but physically, emotionally, socially. Every aspect of your life, if you give everything to God, he will then listen to you fully and completely. If you don't, well, that's your choice. He can't force anything on you. He will not force anything on you. Verse 14 summarizes the message.
I will be found by you, says the Lord, and I will bring you back from your captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and from all the places where I have driven you, says the Lord, and I will bring you to the place from which I caused you to be carried away captive.
He will get you from wherever you are, he said to these people. I will take you from wherever you are, and I will lead you back to the land of Canaan, which represents heaven itself, of course. Now, this is probably, or was, a great boon to the people of Israel at that time. But what about us in the 21st century? Has this been just a history lesson for someone who lived 2,600 years ago, roughly? No, it's not. Because somehow our hearts, our minds actually realize that this is a message for more than the people 2,600 years ago. It's also a message at least for two other lots of people. Now we can interpret it in two other ways. Firstly, the first way is for Christians as a whole. And secondly, for each individual, you can interpret it individually. Now, I want to look at that, because that is much more important than having just the history lesson. The history lesson was important purely to understand what happened then, and now we want to apply what we have learned. The words still give comfort to us. We instinctively find that they somehow apply to us, that they are for us also, that these words were never meant only for the slaves in Babylon. God's plans for us are also wonderful. God's plans for you, each and every one of you, whoever you might be, whatever situation you're in, God's plans for you are wonderful plans. He doesn't want you to suffer or be hurt. God cares for you. When Adam and Eve came out of creation, in the book of Genesis, first chapter, after creation, it says it was, what? Very good. It was perfect. The problems that we face are all brought from the enemy of souls, Satan. That's where it comes from. Now, why did God not just obliterate Satan? Well, love does not compel. God is not just the God of love. I say, is not just the God of love, because He is love. He's not just a God of love. He is love. Love is His main characteristic. Love is who He is. He cannot push you. Parents with children know that they love their kids and they want to push their kids, and they can up until they get to their formative years, and then they have to realize that it cannot keep going that way. Because the children have to make their own decisions. That is what God's like. He leads us along the path of life, and then He leaves the decisions to us. Even if we are going to make decisions that are going to hurt us, it hurts Him to see us hurt us. But He will not intervene unless we ask for His help. And then He will run to us like the father and the prodigal son story or parable. He will come and He will help us. Love does not compel. Babylon represents to us here in the 21st century all powers and people which are and who lead us into slavery. It's not one organization, it's not one person. Because the book of Revelation says that Babylon, in Revelation 17 verse 5, says Babylon is the mother of prostitutes and the abominations of the earth. It's the mother of. There are many things. For you, Babylon might be alcohol. Might be drugs. It might be money. It might be your job. Great job where you spent endless hours. I did that. Boy, was I a good little busy bee. The point is that all this is good, but it's not the best. Your Babylon may be lust, envy. A lot of these things look innocent and innocuous to start with, but they can lead you down the wrong track. Babylon can be anything that takes us away from God. Anything that is taking a greater position than God. And many of us have gods. My biggest god, hopefully not now, but in the past, was a guy standing in front of you. I thought I knew everything. None of you are like that here, and that's good. I'm glad of that. We can put ourselves on a pedestal at times as well. Even now we live as foreigners in a foreign land. We are aliens. This world is a foreign land because our home is not here. Where is our home? It's the heavenly Canaan. It's heaven. It's New Jerusalem. That's where we should be going. This is only a place we are passing through. It's only a temporary place. God wants us to choose Jesus. He wants Jesus to be our guide, our friend, as well as our Savior. He wants Jesus to live inside of us, to help us, direct us. Now, we instinctively want a better country, a better place, but, in the meantime, we're living in this earth. Now, we are living in the blessed country, the lucky country, Australia. Not that it's perfect, but if you look around the news about the Middle East, Pakistan, Afghanistan, so many other parts of the world, things are not good. If you've got relatives there, you know that. You know how bad things are. In the meantime, we have to live in Babylon. We are living in Babylon. We have to accept that, and we have to make sure that we get to the point where we can move to the New Jerusalem. There's a long time to live for some of us. For others like me, a little bit less time. But there's a long way to go before you can walk into Babylon, into New Jerusalem, out of Babylon. We need to work for this world. We need to work for this country. We need to work for this city, for this neighborhood around us, Concord. That's what God is telling us in Jeremiah 29. We've got to work for these people and help them in every way possible. We have to pray for them. That's his message for us today. In the same way that it was difficult for the good Israelites, in 605 BC and 596 BC, it's not always easy for us. It can be very difficult. Life was not necessarily meant to be easy, said one of our politicians. And boy, he was right. Because of the increase of wickedness, the love of many will grow cold. Matthew 24, verse 12. Additionally, people will faint from terror, apprehensive of what is coming on the world. Luke 21, 26. There will be wars and rumors of wars, famines and earthquakes everywhere. Matthew 24, 6. And many more difficulties will occur, threatening our very existence. What is required of us to know is God's plans for us. In the meantime, what are God's plans for us? We've gone through them. It's nothing dramatic. You are to live a sensible life. You are to help all those around you, the country. You are to pray for them. You are to be a benefit to them. That's what God's plans are, immediately. But in the future, if you do that, and if you trusting God, if you trust His Son to change you, then you will walk into New Jerusalem. That's what's going to happen. Matthew heard and repeats the words of Jesus as he advises all Christians of all ages. He says this in Matthew 24:13, "The one who stands firm to the end." Firm to the end. Now, in Revelation 14 and verse 12, the same message is given, and it says, it calls for patient endurance. Endurance. Is endurance good news? Do you have to endure good times? When we use the word endure, it normally means that there are bad times. There's something bad happening. We have to endure it to get what is good after that. Now, back in Jeremiah chapter 29, the prophet mentions a period of 70 years for the time of captivity. Now, what that means for the followers of Jesus at the end of time is that not everyone will make it through to Jesus' return. I'm reconciled to the fact that I may not be there. Not immediately there, but hopefully I'll be in the grave and be resurrected at the first resurrection, not the second one. But that's really not a major issue for me anymore, but it's easier for me to say that. I'm 73, I've lived my life. It's a lot harder for you young people because you want to live your life. And God wants you to enjoy your life. He wants you to have a great life. He's not saying it's only up there. You are to have a good life here too. But it's more important up there. It's more important to prepare for what's up there. Now, we have to endure. But about that day or hour when Jesus returns, how many people know? How many beings know? It says no one. No one except the Father in heaven. Not even Jesus Christ. Not even the Holy Spirit. Only the Father in heaven. So, look, don't stress about when it's going to be. That's not for you or me to know. It doesn't really matter. What it says here, though, in another parable, is that when you see spring approaching and you see the first buds on the tree, know that it is near, that spring is near, that it is even at the door. The signs are there. Christ is coming soon. But don't stress about exact hours or days or places. It's not for us to know. Our hope is, however, in the future life. Our salvation has to be sure if we have accepted Jesus. That's all we need to stress about, or focus about. Just build that relationship with Jesus Christ. If you build that relationship, all else will take care of itself. Are you going to be ready? Are you going to be ready? That's the question. None of us can get ourselves ready, but Jesus can. The Holy Spirit can. Let's give our lives fully and completely to Him, for He will do what we can't do.